All right, you guys, let's go ahead and get started. Start off by saying Shabbat Shalom. All praises to the Most High, Ahaya. Hope everybody's having an Irab Tawab. A good evening. Tonight's lesson, we're going to go back into part two. Part two of last week's lesson, the curses, where we was breaking down Deuteronomy 28, so everybody can get and have a little better understanding on who these curses fit. So now, last week we did Deuteronomy 28, and I think we made it all the way to verse 45. So this week, We're gonna re-step a little bit though. We're gonna go back into a couple of verses that we went over last week and break them down thoroughly so you can have all the information you need when it comes to explaining this stuff to individuals. All right? Let's start off where we started last week. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28:68. And then we'll get into the meat and potatoes right off the rip. Deuteronomy 28:68. So last week, lesson was called "Who Fits These Curses?" These curses that have been written, that was written in Deuteronomy 28. And this week we're going to continue and break these curses down. Deuteronomy 28:68 reads, oh, and before I go into the lesson, sorry about Wednesday. I know a lot of people were jumping online, and I didn't realize until like 9:05, 9:10 that something was wrong with the line, but I kept seeing everybody jump on, and then I was seeing people jump off, and then I was seeing people jump on, and I didn't realize that something was wrong with the line until about 9:10 or so. So you guys, anytime something like that is going on, you have to text me and say, hey, is something wrong with the line, or inform me that you guys are trying to get on and you're having a problem. Close that door right there. Okay, so my apologies. I didn't know that. I just kept seeing everybody get on, everybody get off, everybody get on, everybody get off. So for future reference, make sure you guys just text me and let me know what's going on. Deuteronomy 28:68 reads, and the Most High shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. Alright? So, when it says no man shall buy you, you are now bondmen and bondwomen. Bondman means a servant, which is a slave, and bondwoman means a female slave, a female servant. Okay? So last week we read Deuteronomy 28:1 all the way to verse 45. But like I said, this week we're going to recap a little and break down what people went into bondage. Okay? What group of people went into bondage and how they went into bondage? Because when you try to break this down to people and tell them, well, these people that it's talking about in Deuteronomy 28 are a certain group of people, and you got ignorant people out there that are trying to tell you, well, nah, that's everybody. Well, different people went into bondage. Well, different people went into slavery. So that's why tonight we're going into specifics to give certain information so you guys can have ammunition to where you can break this down to people. Alright? So let's go to let's recap. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28:25. I know we went over this last week, but we're going to break it down a little more thoroughly this week, because this is the main one people try to tell you. When you try to say, well, you know, a certain group of people went into slavery, then people will be like, well, a lot of different groups went into slavery. And if you don't know your information, then you'll be kind of stumped right there and be like, well, okay, yeah, that is true. So I'm going to give you the information tonight to where you can break it down, to where you can show them who the Bible is talking to and about according to going into slavery. Not what you then picked up in another book and read. No, we're talking about who the true people are of the Bible. Deuteronomy 25 reads, "The Most High shall curse thee to be smitten before thy enemies." That means smitten means taken into war, taken into captivity. "Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth." So the Most High says when you are taken down in wars, or when you go to war with your enemies, you're going to be taken down. And once you're taken down in war, you're going to be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. Okay? And last week we broke down a couple of kingdoms that a group of people was put on that ship called Jesus Lebet. And they was brought over into Brazil. They was brought over into South America. They was brought over into Europe. So now tonight we're going to break down four major kingdoms that the children of Israel was taken into concerning the Bible. Okay, and then that will give you a lot of firepower when you're talking to people. Let's go to 2 Kings 17 and 6. So like I said, when you go tell people, well, you know, the Bible talks about a specific group of people going into slavery. And you know, when they went into slavery, they went into different kingdoms. And people say, well, you have the Jewish people, they was put in slavery. You have the Asians, they were put in slavery. You have, so a lot of people will talk about different people being put into slavery, but we're going to keep it with the Bible tonight on what the Bible talks about. Not about what all these other books is reading. We're going to keep everything to the scripts, right? So 2 Kings 17 and 6, all right? And it reads, "In the ninth year of Hosea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria and placed them in Hala and in harbor by the river of Gaza and in the cities of the Medes." All right? Go to 2 Kings 24 and 10. So it tells you that the children of Israel was carried into Assyria, and they were also carried into the cities of the Medes. Okay? And we're going to break this stuff down. 2 Kings 24 and 10. Reads, "At that time, the servants of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up against Jerusalem, and the city was besieged. And Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came against the city, and his servants did besiege it. And Jehoiakim, the king of Judah, went out to king of Babylon. He and his mother and his servants and his princes and his officers. And the king of Babylon took him in the eighth year of his reign." All right, verse 13, 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 13 reads, "And he carried out thence all the treasures of the house of the Most High, and the treasures of the king's house, and cut in pieces all the vessels of gold which Solomon, king of Israel, had made in the temple of the Most High. And the Most High had said, and he carried away all Jerusalem, and all the princes, and all the mighty men of Valar, even 10,000 captives, and all the craftsmen and smiths, none remained, save the poorest sort of the people of the land. And he carried away Jehoiakim to Babylon, and the king's mother, and the king's wives, and his officers, and the mighty of the land, those carried he into captivity from Babylon, from Jerusalem to Babylon." So right here, Israel, which is Jerusalem, all of Jerusalem was carried into Babylon for captivity. Alright? The Babylonian Empire represents the lion. Alright? Let's go to Daniel 7-1. So tonight, we're going to break these kingdoms down. Deuteronomy 28 and 25 says, and thou shalt be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. So we're going to break down the major kingdoms that the Bible talks about. Babylon is the first major kingdom that we're going to break down tonight that Jerusalem was carried into. All right? And that's what we just read in 2 Kings 24. Now let's go to Daniel 7:1. Daniel 7:1 reads, in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matter. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. So it says in his dream, in his vision, he saw four great beasts, and all of them were different from one another. That's what diverse means. Verse 4. Daniel chapter 7, verse 4. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. So this lion was the first great kingdom of the first beast. So it says we have four beasts, four great beasts. And the first of the four beasts was a lion, which had eagle's wing. And this lion right here represents the Babylonian Empire. Okay? And what we just read in 2 Kings 24 lets you know that Jerusalem, all of Jerusalem, which is Israel, was carried into captivity to Babylon. Okay? And when you break down the line, which is Babylon, it's talking about ancient Babylon, which is Iraq. Okay? So that's the difference from Babylon that you're reading of today and Babylon right here. This Babylon right here is speaking of ancient Iraq. So that's one kingdom that Israel was carried captive into. Deuteronomy 28:25 says, and it shall be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. So that's the first kingdom. All right, let's go to Ezra 4:1. Let's go to Ezra 4:1. So now we're going to break down the second kingdom. Okay? Now, everybody's not going to fit these kingdoms that the Bible's talking about. The Bible says you shall be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. There's only one group of people. There's only a certain group of people that went into captivity into every major kingdom of this earth. Okay? And once I give you these precepts tonight and information, now you will be able to go and talk to somebody and show them the logic and the truth behind Deuteronomy 28. Ezra 4:1 reads, now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the children of the captivity built the temple unto the Most High, thy power of Israel, then they came to Zerubbabel, and to the chief of the fathers, and said unto them, let us build with you, for we seek your power, as ye do, and we do sacrifice unto him since the days of Esarhaddon, king of Asher, which brought us up hither. So it says, when Judah and Benjamin, the children of captivity, they was building a temple unto the Most High, and then they came to Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel came to them and said, let us be a part of this building that you're building to your power. Verse 3. Ezra chapter 4, verse 3. But Zerubbabel and Jeshua and the rest of the chief of the fathers of Israel said unto them, ye have nothing to do with us to build an house unto our power. So the children of Israel looked at them and said, y'all got nothing to do with us, so we're not going to let y'all participate with us in the building of this building towards our power. But we ourselves together will build unto the power, the Most High, thy power of Israel, as King Cyrus and the king of Persia had commanded us. Then the people of the land weakened the hands of the people of Judah and troubled them in building. So when they realized that Judah and Benjamin was not going to let them participate in the building, then they weakened the hands. They started taking things from them to where they couldn't build no more and started handicapping. Verse 5. Ezra chapter 4, verse 5. And hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose. All the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even to the reign of Darius, king of Persia. And in the reign of Assuerus, in the beginning of his reign, wrote they unto him an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. So it lets you know right here that the children of Israel was in captivity under the king of Persia. And when you break down Persians, which is your Medes, all right, so in the Bible speaks of the Medes. And when you break down the Medes, it tells you that it's the Persians. Okay, actually, let's go to it. Let's see. Let me show y'all when the Bible talks about the Medes, how it's talking about the Persians. Let's go to, let me get a good precept here. Let's go to Jeremiah 51 and 28. Jeremiah 51 and 28. All right. Jeremiah 51 and 28 says, prepare against her the nations with the kings of the Medes, the captains thereof, and all the rulers thereof, and all the land of his dominion. Alright, and when you break down the word Medes, Medes let you know that it's the Persians. Okay? So they are the same people. Alright, let's go to let's go to Daniel 5 and 28. Daniel 5 and 28. Daniel 5 and 28 reads, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Alright, so when that kingdom was divided, it was split in two for the Medes and the Persians, which are the same group of people. Daniel 5 and 28 says, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Okay, so don't let nobody tell you when you're talking about the Medes that it's not the Persians. These are the same two people. So now when we read in Ezra, where it says Benjamin and Judah, which is Israel, was under the hands of the king of Cyrus, the king of Persia. The empire of Persia is talking about the empire of the Medes, which is the bear. Alright, who is the bear? Let's go back to Daniel 7 and 5. So we stopped at Daniel 7 and 4. Let's go to Daniel 7 and 5. So Israel was in captivity under Cyrus, the king of Persia. Then Darius, the king of Persia. King of Persia represents the Medes, which is the empire of the Medes. Daniel 7 and 5 reads, and behold, another beast, a second, like to a bear. And it raised up itself on one side. And it had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. So the bear represents the empire of the Medes. Alright, so the first empire, okay, represents the lion, which is the Babylonian Empire, ancient Iraq. The second kingdom, which is the empire of the Medes, which represents the bear. And when it said it had three ribs in his mouth, it's talking about the three ribs that was in his mouth was Babylon, Lydia, and Egypt. Those are the three ribs that were in the mouth of this bear. Why? Because this bear had to take these people, this kingdom, that kingdom down in order for it to become the kingdom that it was. So when the bear, which is the Medes, became the next big kingdom, it had to take the lion out, which was Babylon. So that's why the three ribs in his mouth represents Babylon, Lydia, and Egypt. All right? Let's go to the next. Let's go to Joel. Some people say Joel. Let's go to chapter 3, verse 1. Joel or Joel 3 and 1. So now we broke down two kingdoms so far. And Deuteronomy 28:25 says, the Most High shall cause thee to be smitten before thy enemies, taken down in war. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. Like I said, reason why we're going over this tonight, because I want to show y'all there's only one group of people that went into every single kingdom and did into captivity. Alright, and this is how you can figure out who these true people are of the Bible. Alright? Joel 3 and 1 reads, for behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem. So here we go again. We're going into captivity again. And I will also gather all nations and bring them down into the valley of Josaphat, and I will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. So it lets you know right here, the Most High is speaking, says, I will plead with them for my people and for my heritage. So he says, for my people and my heritage. So who is his people? Who is his heritage? Okay, there's only a certain group of people that's his people. And that's his heritage. Alright? And he says he will plead for them. And when he pleads for them, he says, all my people have what? Been scattered among the nations. So all my people, which is Israel, have been scattered among all these kingdoms and parted my land. And they have cast lots for my people and have given a boy for an harlot and sold a girl for wine that they may drink, that they might drink. So when it says a boy for a harlot, that means a boy has been taken into war and he's been hired basically as an harlot. What's a harlot? A whore. So when they took a boy from Israel into war, they would use him as a whore. They would use him any way they want to. Alright? Just like when you hire a whore, you do whatever you want. So when they took a boy from Israel and brought him into war, they treated them any way they wanted and put them on the front line, put them on the back line, put them at the top, treated them like a harlot. Okay? And he was in verse 4. Verse 4 reads, yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and all the coast of the Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return your recompense upon your own head? Because ye have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things, the children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. So right here, children of Israel is taken into captivity, and they were sold to who? The Grecians. Alright, so this is another powerful kingdom. Okay? Let's break down who the Grecians is. The Grecians is your Greek empire. Let's go to Daniel 7 and 6. So let's go back to Daniel 7. Daniel 7 and 6. So right here is in Joel 3 and 6, it says, the children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their borders. So they were removed far from Israel. They were removed far from Jerusalem. And this time around, they were sold into the Grecians. So the first time around, they went into captivity with Babylon. Second time around, they went into captivity with the Persians, which is the Medes. Third time around, they're into captivity with the Grecians. Let's find out what the Grecians is. Daniel 7 and 6 reads, after this, I beheld, and lo, another, like a leper, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and the dominion was given to him. So the leper represents Alexander the Great, which is the Greek Empire. Okay? So Israel went into captivity under this empire also. All right? And it says the beast had four heads and dominion was given to it. The four heads represents four generals that took over after Alexander the Great was taken down. So when they took Alexander the Great out, you already had four generals in place to keep this great empire going when Alexander the Great was taken out. That's what the four heads represent. Okay, so now we have three of the great empires, which are the great kingdoms that the Most High speaks of in the Bible, speaking of Israel going into captivity. Alright, so when people try to tell you everybody went into captivity, everybody, no, we're speaking of who went into captivity in all these different kingdoms. Alright, these are the people that fit the curse that Deuteronomy 28 and 25 is speaking of. Alright, let's get to the last great kingdom that the Most High spoke of. Let's go to John 11 and 45. So in Daniel's vision, in Daniel 7, he's speaking of in his dream four great beasts, four great kingdoms that came in and did their thing. Okay? They came in and they did their thing. It's really five. And we'll break down the fifth one. It's really five that Daniel speaks of. Even though he says four great beasts, but there's really five in this prophecy in Daniel 5. John, St. John 11 and 45 reads, then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Yeshaya did, believed on him. So it says many of the Jews came to Mary and they seen all these miracles that Yeshaya had did, and they believed him. And if you read the story before what we're reading on right here, if you read the rest of St. John chapter 11 before this, it's talking about how a man was dead and the Jews came to Yeshaya, and Yeshaya went to the grave and told them to remove the stone of the dead man. And they said, why are you going to remove the stone? He's already been dead for 4 days. He stinks. And Yeshaya said, listen, just do what I say. Remove the stone. And he removes the stone and touches the man, and the man arises and walks. And the people were astonished. They couldn't believe what they had just seen. Okay? So once they seen this, them Jews went to Mary and was like, wow, we can't believe what Yeshaya just did. Alright, 46. Verse 46, St. John chapter 11, verse 46. But some of them went their ways to the Pharisees. So not all of the Jews went to Mary. Some went to Mary and couldn't believe what they seen, and then the rest of them went their way to the Pharisees and told them the things Yeshaya had done. Then gathered their chief priests and the Pharisees a council. So verse 47 says, then gathered the chief priests and the Pharisees a council and said, what do we? For this man doeth many miracles. So now the Pharisees, when they're finding out to the Jews that Yeshaya was pulling off many miracles, they said, what are we going to do about this? Verse 48. If we let him thus alone, so if we don't do nothing, all men will believe on him. So everybody will start believing on him and following him if we don't do nothing. And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation. So the Pharisees said, hey, if we continue to let him go through and do all these miracles, then everybody's going to start following him. And if we don't do nothing about this, then the Romans are going to come take us out. That's basically what they said. So at this time, right here, the Romans are in charge. When Yeshaya was here in the flesh, the Romans are in charge. Alright? And the Romans is who killed who? The Messiah. The Romans killed the Messiah. Okay? So now this is the empire that's in charge. This is the empire that everybody's scared of. Is the Roman Empire. So that's why the Pharisees said, hey, we gotta stop the Messiah from performing all these miracles, because if we don't do nothing, the Romans are going to come put us in our place. Matthew 27:1. St. Matthew chapter 27 verse 1. So now, first empire, the Babylonian Empire, which is ancient Babylon, Iraq, okay, which represents the lion. Second empire, the bear, which represents the Persians, which is the empire of the Medes. Third empire, which represents the leopard, which is the Grecians, the Greek Empire under Alexander the Great. And now we're on the fourth empire, which is the Roman Empire. Matthew chapter 27 verse 1 reads, when the morning was come, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Yeshaya to put him to death. So this is when Yeshaya was about to be put to death. And it says, when that morning came, all the chief priests and the elders and the council came against Yeshaya to put him to death. Verse 2, Matthew chapter 27, verse 2. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Let's break down Pilate. Pilate is G4091, and it's Pilatos, P-I-L-A-T-O-S, Pilatos, and Pilate, which is Pilatos, means close, press, that is firm, a Roman. So it tells you right here, when you break down Pilate, G4091, that Pilate means Roman. He was a Roman. So Pontius Pilate, the governor, was a Roman. Okay? So a Roman, the Romans is who killed Yeshaya. Okay? As clear as day. Alright? So once Pilate, the Roman, killed off Yeshaya, then they started putting the apostles in prison. So once they killed off Yeshaya, they started putting the apostles in prison. And once they started putting the apostles in prison, they started killing them. Let's go to Acts 5 and 16. Acts 5 and 16. So now that we know Pilate, Pontius Pilate, who killed Yeshaya was a Roman, because many people don't want to believe that. You can tell somebody tomorrow, you know the Romans killed the Messiah. What? Who told you that? It's in the Bible. And we just broke down Pilate, who was the governor, who bound Yeshaya on the morning that he was going to be put to death, and he was a Roman. Okay? And like I said, once they killed the Messiah, the Romans, then those same Romans started putting the apostles in prison for speaking the words of Yeshaya and telling them to be quiet. And once they was not quiet, then they started killing them off. Acts 5 and 16. Acts 5 and 16 reads, "There came also a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits. And they were healed everyone. Then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles, and put them in common prisons." So Acts 5 and 18 tells you that they put their hands, they started beating up on the apostles, and put them in prison. All right, and these people are the Romans, the same people that put Yeshua to death. Okay, verse 19. "But the angel of the Most High by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, Go, stand, and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." So when the Romans put the apostles in prison, the angel of the Most High came and opened the doors and let them out. And then told them to go speak the words of the Most High. Don't listen to them. Don't let them cast you in prison and close your mouth. Go speak the word. Verse 21. Acts chapter 5, verse 21. "And when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and talked. But the high priest came, and they that were with him, and called the council together, and all the descendants of the children of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and found them not in the prison, they returned and told." So the high priest sent the officers to the prison to grab the apostles to bring them to him. And when they went back, the apostles wasn't there. Verse 23, saying, "The prison truly found we shut with all safety." So they said, "Hey, we promise you we locked this prison down. And the keepers standing without before the doors, but when they had opened, we found no man within." So they said, "Listen, we promise you, before we left last night, we secured that prison, locked every door. We had guards, and we don't know what happened." Verse 24, Acts chapter 4, verse 24. "Now when the high priest and the captain of the temple and the chief priest heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. Then came one and told them, saying, Behold, the men whom ye put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." So he says, "Hey, you know what? We found them. And they are in the temple at the top of the stairs teaching the people what you told them not to do. Then went the captain with the officers and brought them without violence. For they feared the people, lest they should have been stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council." So when they got the apostles, they brought them before the council. And the high priest asked them, saying, "Did we straightly command you that ye should not teach in this name?" So verse 28 says, "Did we straightly tell y'all not to teach in his name? We put you in prison and told you not to teach in his name," talking about the Messiah. But remember, verse 19 says the angel opened the door and told them to go speak the words of the Most High. So who are you going to listen to? The Romans? Or are you going to listen to the Spirit of the Most High? Verse 28, Acts 5 and 28. Saying, did not we straightly command you that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. So the Romans said, listen, and by the way, the Romans, all right, which took over the Grecians, the name Jesus is what? A Greek name, right? Jesus is a Greek name. Okay, so this is how you know they got stuff screwed up. Jesus is a Greek name, and then these same people, the Romans who took over the Greeks, are saying, "Did we tell you not to teach in this man's name?" Talking about the Messiah. Okay, "You have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood upon us." So now you're going to teach everybody that we are the ones that killed him. That's what bringing this man's blood upon us. Verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, "We ought to obey the Most High rather than man." The father, the power of our fathers raised up Yeshayah, whom you slew and hung on a tree. So Peter said, listen, now that they gathered us up and brought us before the council, we're not going to back down. We're not going to obey man. We're going to continue to obey Ahiah. Ahiah told us to teach, so we're going to teach. And they says, the person that you hung on the tree. So this right here lets you know that Yeshayah was hung on the tree. Because every time the apostles speak in reference of Ahiah, or Yeshayah, I mean, they tell you that he was hung on the tree. Okay? Why? Because they are the ones who were there and witnessed how he was killed. Acts 5 and 31. Him had Ahiah exalted with his right hand to be the prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of our sins. So when the apostles speak of him, they call him the savior. And when you break down the word savior, it means Yasha. Alright? And when you add Yah to it, that means my savior. Let's go to Acts 16 and 36. So now, let's go to Acts 16 and 36. So now we're breaking down the curses. Who fit these curses? Deuteronomy 28, 25 says, the people that were going to be cursed were going to be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. We broke down one major kingdom already, which is Babylonian Empire, which represents the lion, which is ancient Iraq. Then we broke down the second empire that Israel is taking into captivity, which is the Persians, which is the empire of the Medes, which is the bear. The third empire, which is the Grecians, which is the Greek empire under Alexander the Great, which is the leopard. And now we're still breaking down the Roman Empire. Acts 16 and 36 reads, and the keeper of the prison told this saying to Paul, the magistrates have said to let you go. Now therefore depart and go in peace. So when the apostles, they're locked up again. You got to understand that the apostles, once Yeshayah was killed, the apostles were thrown in prison every other week almost. They kept throwing them into prison because they wasn't listening. And then after a while, that's when they finally said, you know what? There's no reason to throw y'all in prison. We're just going to kill y'all off. Verse 37. But Paul said unto them, they have beaten us openly, uncondemned, being Romans, and have cast us into prison. And now, do they thrust us out privately? Nay, verily. But let them come themselves and fetch us out. So, the guards of the prison came to Paul and says, hey, they set y'all free, y'all can go. And then Paul says, nah, we ain't going nowhere. Do you realize the Romans are the ones that threw us in here? And then the guards was like, huh? So Paul was like, nah, we're not going nowhere. Let the Romans themselves come. They're going to come and fetch us out if we leave out here. They're going to come and bring us back in here. Verse 38. And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. So they didn't realize the Romans were the ones that kept throwing the apostles into prison. Okay? So the Romans is who killed Yeshayah. The Romans are the ones that kept throwing the apostles in prison. Let's go to Daniel 7 and 7. So we already read Daniel's 1 through 6. I mean Daniel 7, 1 through 6. So now let's go to Daniel 7 and 7. Okay? So we're talking about these four major empires. And so far, Israel has been into captivity with three of these major empires. No other group of people has gone into captivity in all these empires. And if they have, I want somebody to look that information up and find it for me. Show me what group of people went into all four of these major empires in captivity. And when you find that information, call me. Let me know. I'm waiting. Daniel 7 and 7 reads, after this I saw in the night vision, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. So it tells you that this next beast out of the four beasts was powerful. It was more powerful than the three beasts that were before it. Okay? And this is the Roman Empire. Remember, when the Roman Empire was around, it wasn't nothing like it. Very powerful. Okay? So you had the Babylonian Empire, which is the lion. Then the bear, which is the Persians, took that empire down. Okay? And then you have the leopard, which is the Grecians who came in, Alexander the Great, and then they took down the Persians, which was the bear. And then the Roman Empire came in, great, exceedingly strong, and they took down Alexander the Great and the Grecians, and they became the most powerful empire. All right, and at the end of this, it says, and this empire had 10 horns. These 10 horns represent the EU. Back then, who was the EU? Italy, France, Spain, Germany, Britain, Asia, Greece, Egypt, Pannonia, and Sarmata. Those back then considered the EU, which were the 10 horns. Back in the day, that was under the Roman Empire. Alright? So those empires were great. Great and big. Okay? Let's go back to Deuteronomy real fast. Go to Deuteronomy 28:45. So now that we know we're on the Roman Empire, Roman Empire was, so far, this is the biggest empire of them all. It's strong, it's huge, it's stumping things into pieces, it's taking over. And nothing's like it. Alright? So far, Israel has gone into captivity, into all these places, four major kingdoms. Alright, that's what we read in Deuteronomy 28:25. Let's skip down to 45. Deuteronomy 28:45. And it reads, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee, and shall pursue thee, and overtake thee, till thou be destroyed. Because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Most High thy power, to keep his commandments, and his statutes will he command thee. So the Most High said, all these curses are going to come upon thee. All these curses will pursue thee. Why? Because you didn't hearken unto me. Okay? What does the word curse mean? Remember last week when we broke down curses? Curses mean debase. Debase is reduced in rank. That's what curses is. Curses means debase, reduced in rank. So who in this world was reduced in rank? Okay, and who in this world went into captivity in all these different places? Okay, verse 46, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 46. And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever. So the Most High says these curses, this captivity is going to be upon thy seed forever. Not just for the people back in those days. Alright, in B.C. and A.D. No, these curses are forever. Because thou servest not the Most High thy power with joyfulness and with gladness of heart. For the abundance of all things, verse 48, therefore shalt thou serve thy enemies which the Most High shall send against thee, in hunger, and in thirst, in nakedness, and in want of all things. So it says, you're going to serve your enemies for everything. For hunger, so for food, you're going to serve your enemy for food. So when you want food, you got to serve your enemy. When you want something to drink, you got to serve your enemies. If you want clothing, you have to serve your enemies. That's what that means. All right? And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he hath destroyed you. What group of people had the yoke of iron upon their neck? Go Google it right now and just Google yoke of iron on neck. That's what you put in Google. Go to Google. I ain't gonna even Google it with you. That's just something you can do on your own. Go to Google and put yoke of iron on neck and see who come up. Somebody do it for me and you tell me. Alright? And he says, and he shall put the yoke of iron upon thy neck and you until you have been destroyed. Verse 49. The Most High shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as an eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. So now, you did the yoke of iron? I see you on the smile. Where'd it come up?
Slaves,
yeah, okay. So now verse 49 breaks down that a nation from afar was going to come against Israel. And this nation was going to be swift as an eagle's flight. And they were going to have a different language. That's what it means when it says a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. So now this is the fifth empire that I was talking about. Remember I said Daniel breaks down four beasts, but there's really five. Let's break down this nation that Deuteronomy 28-49 speaks of. I'm reading again. The Most High shall bring a nation against thee from afar, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. So this is a nation that's far from everybody else. Okay? Let's break this nation down. Go back to Daniel 7. Go back to Daniel 7 and 7. Alright? So let's break down this fifth nation. So we already got four nations. First nation, Babylonian Empire, which is the lion, ancient Iraq. The next one was the bear, Medo-Persian, the Persians, the Medes. The leopard, which is the Greeks, Alexander the Great. The Romans, all right, which is the exceedingly strong empire, the Roman Empire. Now we're going to break down the fifth empire. Let's start in Daniel 7 and 7 again. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Verse 8. I considered the horn. So remember, Daniel, this is a vision. He says, and I considered the horn. So I'm paying attention to these 10 horns now. Now that I've seen this fourth beast, I'm focused on these 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three horns, before there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of men, and the mouth speaking great things. So he says, Daniel says, listen, I was considering these 10 horns. And in these 10 horns, one little horn, all right, and there came another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. So what does that mean? It says out of the 10 horns, three horns were taken out, and one horn came out of nowhere and took three horns down. That's what it says. All right, what three horns were taken out? Can anybody remember? We've done this lesson before. Can anybody tell me what three horns were taken out? Okay, anybody online? Can anybody online that we've done this lesson before tell me the three horns that were plucked up by the roots? Let me read it again. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, and before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. Who were the three horns plucked up? All right, France, Britain, and Spain. So remember, I told you out of the 10 horns, France, Britain, and Spain were part of those 10 horns. But France, Britain, and Spain were taken out by this little horn that came. Who was the little horn? America. America is the little horn. And America had to take out France, Spain, and Britain in order for them to become an empire. And once they took out Spain, Britain, and France, then that's when France came and said, hey, you guys were pretty tough. We don't want y'all to come mess with us ever again. So guess what? We're going to make this statue in honor of a peace treaty. And as long as y'all have this statue on y'all land, this equals peace between you and I. That's what France said. France said, we don't want nothing else to do with y'all. So we're going to make this statue for y'all. And we want y'all to put this on y'all land since now y'all are a great empire. And as long as we see that statue, we know we're good. Guess what statue that is? The Statue of Liberty. When you do your homework on the Statue of Liberty, it tells you two guys from France made that statue and they brought it over here to America in representation of peace. All right? But let's break down this little horn. All right? Let's read Daniel 7 and 8 again at the end. And it says, and in this horn were eyes like the eyes of men and a mouth speaking great things. So this new horn, which is America, it spoke great things. All right? They were really good with their tongue, psychology, philosophy. America knew how to work the deal. So that's why now today, in this day and age, America, they always working the deals, right? They know how to negotiate. They know how to speak good things and get the deal done. Okay? But remember when we was reading in Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 28 and 49 says, let's go back to Deuteronomy 28 and 49. So now that we know another little horn came up outside those 10 horns, and this little horn took down three horns, which was France, Spain, and Britain. And when they took down those three horns to become a nation itself, this is what gives you your fifth empire outside the Roman Empire. And once the Roman Empire went down, okay, then America became big. So once the Roman Empire started going down, Britain brought the great whore over here to America, and that's when America got all this power. Deuteronomy 28 and 49 reads, the Most High shall bring a nation against thee from afar. So this nation is the nation that's got the yoke of iron on your neck. Remember in verse 48 says you're going to have a yoke of iron on your neck. So this nation that comes against thee from afar is the nation that's putting this yoke of iron on your neck. And from the end of the earth. America is on the opposite side of the earth from everybody else, aren't they? North America, completely far away. As swift as an eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, which is the English language. So the Most High says, y'all not going to understand that English language. That's why King James and some of his counselors translated the King James Bible into the English version, because through prophecy, they knew we were going to be transported over here. But it says this nation is like an eagle. Let's break this down, what this is talking about when it's speaking eagle. Let's go to Obadiah 1 and 1. So the Most High says, this nation said, I shall bring upon you from far away. This nation shall fly as an eagle, swift like an eagle. Let's see what it means when it's talking about swift as the eagle fly. Obadiah 1 and 1. And for new people, that I see a couple of new people online. Obadiah is at the end of the Old Testament. It's right after Daniel, where we was just at. It was after Daniel. You have Daniel, Hosea. Then Obadiah is like a couple of books right after that. Obadiah 1 and 1 reads, the vision of Obadiah, thus said the Most High thy power concerning Edom. Who is Edom? Esau, so-called white man. We have heard a rumor from the Most High. And an ambassador is sent among the heathen. Arise ye, and let us rise up against her in battle. Talking about rise against Edom, Edomites, which is the white man. Behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. Thou art greatly despised. So it says Esau, the so-called white man, he's made small among the heathen. Okay? Verse 3. Obadiah chapter 1, verse 3. The pride of thine heart had deceived thee. Thou that dwellest in the cliffs of the rocks, whose habitation is high, that said in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? Though thou exalt thyself as an eagle. So it tells you that Esau, the so-called white male, exalts himself as an eagle. The same eagle that's been speaking of in Deuteronomy 28 and 49. You exalt thyself as an eagle, and thou set thy nest among the stars. Thence will I bring thee down, said the Most High. So the Most High says, you have set your nest among the stars. Who is he talking about? NASA. Talking about NASA. America has NASA, and they've done so much among the stars. They're going to all these planets, NASA. They got their satellites all up in the sky above the stars. And every time NASA leaves the ground and gets up into space, and once they get to where their destination is, what do they call back in and say to the people down low? The eagle has landed. Listen, it's clear as day who is talking about. Every time NASA has a mission and they go to Mars, and as soon as they hit that destination, they get on the radio and confirm to the NASA Incorporation, the eagle has landed. We're here. Okay? Obadiah 1 and 7. So this fifth kingdom, this small horn, is speaking of America. Obadiah 1 and 7. All the men of Confederacy have brought thee even to the border. The men that were at peace with thee have deceived thee and prevailed against thee. They that eat thy bread have laid a wound under thee. There is none understanding in him. So it says all the men of Confederacy, Esau, all the men of Confederacy, and who has the Confederate flag? We just had a big old thing about the Confederate flag. Where was that? South Carolina? Where the people were killed, and then they had this big old thing about the Confederate flag, and they finally took the Confederate flag down. Verse 8. Shall I not in the day, saith the Most High, even destroy the wise man out of Edom, and understanding out of the mount of Esau? And thy mighty man, O Teman, shall be dismayed, to the end that every one out of the mount of Esau may be cut off by slaughter. For thy violence against thy brother, so it says thy violence against thy brother, Jacob, shame shall cover thee. So Esau, we all know, is the brother of Jacob when you read Genesis chapter 25. Verse 10, Obadiah 1 and 10. For thy violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall cover thee, and thou shalt be cut off forever. In the day that thou stoodest on the other side, in the day that the strangers carried away captive his forces, and foreigners entered into his gates, and cast lots upon Jerusalem, even thou was waste as one of them. So the Most High says, the day that your brother Jacob and his people was carried into captive, you stood on the other side and watched. So since you stood on the other side and watched them get carried away by the strangers. Who are the strangers? They're Americans. You stood and watched your brothers get carried away into this strange land and did nothing. Let me read it again, verse 11. In the day that thou stoodest on the other side, in the day that the strangers carried away captive his forces, and the foreigners, who are the foreigners, America, entered into the gates and cast lots upon Jerusalem, even thou was as one of them. So let's go to Psalms 83 and 1. So the Most High says, listen, Esau, I got a problem with you. You stood on the other side of the gate and watch your brother Jacob, who is Israel, get carried into another land by the foreigners. I got a problem with you. The eagle has landed. I'm going to take you out. And remember, Obadiah 1:7 says, all men of confederacy, so all people of confederacy, have brought thee even to thy border. Psalms 83:1 reads, keep not thou silence, O most, O power. Hold not thy peace, and be not still, O power. For lo, thy enemies make a tumult. Tumult means a loud noise, a war. And they that hate thee have lift up the head. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people, and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, come, and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name Israel may be no more remembered. So it says these people took crafty counsel against the Most High's people. And when they consulted against these people, they said, all right, let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name Israel may be no more in remembrance. So that's why when you go out here nowadays and try to teach the name Israel to people who we are, they don't know who it is. It's been cut off. It's no more in remembrance. Who did this? Verse 5. For they have consulted together with one consent. They are confederate against thee. So didn't we just read that in Obadiah 1:7? When he says that Yahweh came confederacy against us, against thy border. Verse 6. The tabernacles of Edom and the Ishmaelites of Moab and the Hagarenes. So these are different people. When you read down to verse 8, it tells you all the people that was involved in this. So it says, when Esau, when you stood on the other side and you watched this deal happen, okay? Because we all know we ran into to Africa. And when we ran into Africa, the Ishmaelites, which is Arabs, all these different people that were there, the Canaanites, they all came together along with Esau and sold us into slavery. All right, and we broke that down last week on how Queen Elizabeth, she is the one that gave the captain a ship called Jesus LeBec to be able to bring the Americans, to bring Israel over to America. She the one that funded the ship. Let's go back to Obadiah. Obadiah 1:12. So the fifth kingdom, which is America, the eagle who flies swiftly, the kingdom who speaks another tongue that we will not know in that day, which is Esau. Obadiah 1:12 reads, but thou shouldest not have looked on the day of thy brother in the day that he became a stranger. So the Most High says, you should have stood there and watched this happen, Esau. Neither shouldst thou have rejoiced over the children of Judah in the day of their destruction. Neither shouldst thou have spoken proudly in the day of their distress. So when he seen Judah and Israel going down, Esau spoke proudly and was happy. Why? Because Esau said in his heart, you remember when Jacob had got the blessings, he said, I'm going to hunt my brother forever until he's down and out. Verse 13. Thou shouldest not have entered into the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Yea, thou shouldest not have looked on their affliction in the day of their calamity, nor have laid hands on their substance in the day of their calamity. So when we went into slavery, everybody went on and took our substance, took everything that we had, our land, our cattle, jewels, silver, gold. They took everything that belonged to us. That's why we don't have nothing now, because they took it. Verse 14. Neither shouldst thou have stood in the crossway to cut off those of his that did escape. Neither shouldst thou have delivered up those of his that did remain in the days of his distress. So what does that mean when it says you should have not stood in the crossway to cut off those that did escape? So you remember in slavery on the plantation, you had many slaveries that tried to escape. They would be out deep in that field and they would see free. They would take off. Pew! And right when they take off, they would think they're getting away clean like OJ. And as soon as they get across that gate, as soon as they get across that boundary, you'll have somebody standing in the tree, sitting in the tree with his 12 gauge, and just blow his back out. Boom! So that's what it means right here. Neither should thou have stood in the crossway. You stood in the crossway, and when they tried to escape across that crossway, you had somebody there to kill them. Alright? So this is speaking of the American Empire, which is Babylon the Great. So you can't just go speak to somebody and be like, well, you know, America's Babylon. Because if you just leave it like that, people that know their stuff are going to say, no, Babylon is ancient Iraq. And if you don't know your stuff, you're going to sit there with a confused face. America is considered Babylon the Great or the daughter of Babylon. So that's, you need to get it correct. So when you talk to people and you refer to America, you need to say the daughter of Babylon or Babylon the Great. Now, out of all these great empires that we're speaking of, the Bible names off all these great empires. The Bible speaks of all these great empires, all the way to Asia. But you'll never see nowhere in the Bible where it speaks of the name America. Okay? It speaks of Rome. It speaks of the Grecians. It speaks of the Persians. It speaks of the Asians, the Medes, Syria. But you'll never see the word America in the Bible. So this is when you do your homework, it breaks down that Babylon the Great is speaking of America. Let's go to Revelations 18 and 1. Let's go to Revelations 18 and 1. Revelations 18 and 1 reads, and after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power. And the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the Great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. So it tells you that this place right here that is talking about Babylon the Great, everybody, all the nations have drunk and became rich off this place. That's America. Every nation that we know of has done business with this place. That's what it means when it says all the nations have drunk of the wrath of fornication. Verse 4, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not her of her plagues. So that's why the Most High tells us to leave America, because when he come and take America out, he don't want to be here. Just like all these other great empires that we've spoken of tonight, the Most High took them out. They were great at one point, but the Most High came and took them down. So America's time is coming to where he's going to come take them down also, like the Roman Empire, like Alexander the Great, like the Persians, like Babylon. Okay, verse 5. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and the Most High have remembered her iniquities. So it says Babylon, her sins have reached into heaven. We just read where it says, and you have exalted yourself above the stars in Obadiah. So America's NASA all in the skies, they're doing all kinds of things. I was reading something last week. I was watching something on the news last week where this lady basically told her husband that she's been married to for years that she's going to leave him because she's going to Mars. She's going to Mars. So America now has a program to where if you want to leave and go explore on other planets, if you got enough money to do so, you can do so. Okay? So that's why the Most High said, leave. This place has, their sins have reached into heaven. Verse 5, and the Most High had remembered her iniquities. So just because we all live here and forgot what America has done, everybody forgets how America was brought into place. They forget how America slaved people and hungry and didn't pay them. Oh, great America. America is the best place to live. No, it's not. America is the most sinful place ever. So the Most High says, I still remember her sins. Verse 6. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her work in the cup which she had filled to her double. how much she had glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she said in her heart, I sit a queen, I am no widow, and I shall see no sorrow. So go that word queen. That's America saying, I sit as a queen. Who sits as a queen in America? Statue of Liberty. We already broke it down earlier. So the Statue of Liberty is the queen of America. So she says, I sit as a queen. All right. Therefore, verse 8. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine. And she shall be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Most High power who judges her. So the Most High says this place is going to be done in one day. What can take a place out in one day? A nuclear blast. And this is the nuclear blast that America's trying to stop right now with Iran. They know Iran is going to send that blast over here. They know Iran has the missiles that they're going to send over here to take America out. Okay? How do we confirm that this is America? She says, I sit as a queen. Go to verse 23. Revelations 18 and 23. Revelations 18 and 23 says, and the light of the candle shall shine no more at all in thee. Who is it talking about? Statue of Liberty. Statue of Liberty holds a candle, right? That's who he's talking about. And the light shall shine no more at all in thee. So America's, the Statue of Liberty, the one that says, I sit as a queen, he says, the light, once we take you out, once you're done, that light's going to shine no more in thee. All right? But verse 8 says, and her plague shall come in one day. So America's going to be taken down in one day. Let's confirm this. Let's go to Jeremiah 51 and 11. Let's go to Jeremiah 51 and 11. Actually, let's start in verse 6. Jeremiah 51 and 6. Jeremiah 51 and 6 reads, flee out of the midst of Babylon and deliver every man his soul. So this time around, the Most High says, every man needs to deliver his soul. Moses ain't coming this time. Moses ain't coming to deliver you out like he did when he delivered the children from under the hand of Pharaoh. Flee out of the midst of Babylon and deliver every man his soul. Be not cut off in her iniquity, for this is the time of the Most High's vengeance. He will render unto her a recompense. Babylon has been a golden cup in the Most High's hand. So Babylon has been great, that made all the earth drunken, and the nations have drunken of her wine. Therefore, the nations are mad. So it tells you the nations are mad at America. They've drunken of her wine. They did business deals with them. But now these places are mad at America. And what is Obama trying to pass right now in Iran? A really big deal, right? A deal that's out of this world, that's never been done. And Iran's going to hate this deal. And Iran's going to be mad. Exactly what we're reading right here. Iran's going to be pissed off at the end of the day once this deal don't go their way. Verse 8. Babylon is suddenly fallen and destroyed. How for her, take balm for her pain. If so, she may be healed. So these are all the people that live in America and be like, when you try to tell them, no, you got to leave America. America is going down. And they try to tell you, no, America's a great place. Don't you want to go nowhere else? America's the best place to live. Nowhere else is better than America. So now that they see America's going down, income, housing market, everything's going down, these people are going to do whatever they can to fix America. America is a great place. I'm going to stay here and help fix it. Let me read verse 8 again and tell you what the Most High says about fixing Babylon. Babylon is suddenly fallen and destroyed. How for her? Take balm for her pain. So you can put some Neosporin on that cut all you want. She may be healed. So the Most High says, if you put Neosporin on there, it might be healed. Verse 9. We would have healed Babylon, But she is not healed. She cannot be healed, no matter how much balm you put on it. Forsake her and let us go, everyone, into his own country. Everybody that's in America, because America is the most diverse place. Asians, go back home. Arabs, go back home. Israel, Jacob, go back home. Everybody, go back home. For her judgment reached unto heaven and is lifted up even to the skies. The Most High hath brought forth his righteousness. Come and let us declare in Zion the work of the Most High, our power. So a lot of people say, well, when it's time to leave America, where do we go? Tells you right here. Let us declare in Zion. Verse 11. Make bright the arrows. Okay. So this is Revelation 18 and 8 when it says, therefore her plague shall come in one day, death. And you say, well, what can make a place go down in one day? Here we go. Jeremiah 51, 11. Make bright the arrows, gather the shields. The Most High have raised up the spirit of the kings of the Medes. Who are the Medes? The Persians. Who are the Persians? Iran. Okay? The Medes are your Persians, which is Iran. Make bright the arrows, gather the shields. The Most High have raised up the spirit of the kings of the Medes. For his device against Babylon to destroy it, because it is the vengeance of the Most High, the vengeance of his temple. Set up the standard upon the walls of Babylon. Make the watch strong, set up the watchman, prepare the ambushes. So America, before he make bright the arrows, he's going to bring war here. He's going to ambush America with troops from other states, other countries, I mean. Alright? For the Most High had both devised and done that which he spake against the inhabitants of Babylon. Alright? So when it says make bright the arrows, Jeremiah, in his prophecy, when he was seeing this, and he was saying arrows, he was speaking of a nuclear bomb, a missile. Alright? And when you shoot off a missile, it starts at ground level, it goes up into the sky, high, high, high in the sky, and then it comes down on another end. The same way an arrow would come in. Okay, so when Jeremiah was prophesying, he was prophesying this missile coming in to take down Babylon. But he can only explain it in the matter of an arrow. Okay? So you have to understand through prophecy what's being read here. Alright? So now, as of tonight, we broke down five kingdoms that the children of Israel was taken into captivity. Let's go to the precepts that brought us here. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28 and 25. Let's go to the precepts that brought us here. Deuteronomy 28 and 25. And it says, the Most High shall cause thee to be smitten before thy enemies, taken down by thy enemies in war. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all kingdoms of the earth. So it tells you that Israel will do slavery and will be in captivity in all kingdoms of the earth. Alright? So I wanted to take the time tonight to show you the precepts, the scriptures on how Israel went into captivity into all these different kingdoms and what happened. And like I said earlier, there is no other group of people that went into captivity in all these different kingdoms. We only named off five kingdoms tonight. In last week's lesson, we named off at least four kingdoms when you add Europe, when you add South America, when you add Brazil, when you add all those other places, Asia, those are places we talked about last week, right? So when you add all those places from last week's lesson into tonight's lesson with all these places, these are the same group of people that's been in captivity in all these different places. Alright? So that's why the lesson is called Who Fits These Curses? Because when you talk to many people, they'll try to tell you, well, the Jewish people under Adolf Hitler fit these curses. No, they don't. Do you know why Hitler killed them people off? The people, did anybody know? Huh? Hitler got teed off. Hitler said, hold on. Y'all trying to be like some people that y'all not. Y'all calling yourselves Jewish. Y'all following their laws. Y'all following their holy days. Who y'all think y'all are? So Hitler went to killing his people off. Hitler's like, y'all supposed to be like me, a Catholic, and y'all going around calling yourselves Jewish and following these holy days and all these things. I'm killing y'all off. I'm doing away with you people. So people can't go around and say they fit the curses. No, Hitler killed them off because they were trying to be like us. Revelations 2 and 9. Let's close it off in Revelations 2 and 9. This is what these people were doing. And Hitler says, listen, I ain't going to happen. I'm going to take y'all out myself. And guess what? The Most High going to take y'all out too. But I'm going to take y'all out right now. And you have to understand, the Most High says he was going to deal with these fake people. And through the spirit of Hitler, he did just that. Do I got to say it again? The Most High said he was going to take care of these Jewish people, these false people. He said he was going to take them out. And through the spirit of Hitler, he put a spirit on Hitler to take these people out. He did just that. Revelations 2 and 9, we'll close it out with this. Revelations 2 and 9 reads, I know thy works and tribulations and poverty. So this first part of the scripture is talking to Israel. He's talking, Yeshaya right here is talking to Israel. He says, I know your works, I know y'all work hard, I know your tribulation, I know y'all having afflictions everywhere y'all go. I know you guys are in poverty, but thou art rich. You guys are rich in spirit. Don't let the flesh take you down. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogues of Satan. So Yeshaya says, listen, I know the lies of those people who say they are Jews. The people in this world that's in Israel right now lying to be y'all. I know the lies of those fake people. But it says, hey, they are not Jews. They are the synagogues of Satan. Who are the true Jews? Us. But the world that we live in today that tells you who the true Jew people are the people in Israel. Most High says those people are liars. They are blasphemy of what I talk about. But the true Jews of the world today, y'all are in poverty, y'all have hard tribulations, but y'all are rich in the spirit. So remember, that's one of my favorite scriptures, because you can show somebody that. Because in prophecy, he says the true Jews of the Bible, we will be in poverty in the end days. In the end days, we will be in captivity. That's what the scripture said. And when you look at the people in Israel that claim to be Israel and claim to be the true people, they are not in poverty. They are living pretty good. Right? So that right there shows you that that's a lie right there alone. Okay? So with that in mind, we'll go ahead and close it out. We'll pray it out. And if anybody have any questions or anything they would like to say, we'll open it up at the end. We'll say Shabbat Shalom. Let's pray it out.